everybody is here, then I suggest that we start. And it is a real pleasure for me to introduce the first keynote speaker of our conference, who I jokingly referred to a few minutes earlier as the most inter person in this conference, because her whole life and activity is connected to things in between, meaning that she was born in Switzerland and was educated both in Europe and in the United States, and that now she lives in the United States, but she's also fluent in three languages, English, French, of course, and German. And also, maybe as a fun fact, I should also add as a bibliographical biographical reference that back in the 1980s, at the dawn of the digital era, she also was connected to engineering sciences. She worked as a software consultant. Yes, am I right? A programmer for a short time, for some time. And although she says that she has already left those years behind her, and she's no longer practicing anything connected to engineering sciences, I think that her interest in the digital age has remained with her, and making her a keen observer of the contemporary media scene. And in fact, her entire work exemplifies the necessity for humanities in general, and literary studies in particular, to embrace new media phenomena. Now, I'm sure you are all familiar with her work. Nevertheless, I will remind you that she has written extensively on narrative theory, the theory of possible worlds, and the theory of fiction, on cyberculture, and diverse aspects of transmediality. She is author and editor of some truly landmark books in these domains, like Possible Worlds, Artificial Intelligence and Narrative Theory, Narrative as Virtual Reality, Immersion and Interactivity in Literature and Electronic Media, Avatars of Story, Narrative Across Media, The Languages of Storytelling, Intermediality and Storytelling, Cyberspace Textuality, Computer Technology and Literary Theory, and she's co-author of the Routledge Encyclopedia of Narrative Theory. And as I learned, her forthcoming book that she co-edited is titled The Johns Hopkins Guidebook to Digital Humanities. So for today's talk, she has chosen a very provocative title, Transmedia Storytelling, Myth or Reality. And if I understand it right from our previous correspondence, she proposes to examine just how transmedia is transmedia storytelling. So, dear Marie-Laure, thank you for accepting our invitation to come to our conference. It is a pleasure to have you here with such an intriguing topic, and we are all looking eagerly forward to your talk.
I chose my topic when I found out that Henry Jenkins would be here, and I decided to engage in a dialogue with him. This concept of transmedia storytelling is a concept that he has introduced and it has gone viral. So what you do with a virus, you put it under the microscope to see what it consists of, and that's what I'm going to try to do. I call it myth or reality. Is there such a thing as transmedia storytelling? In a sense, I'm playing the devil's advocate, because as you know, the culture of the past 20 years had generated lots of media franchises. So you have cult narratives that generate adaptations that are continually expanded through action figures, toys, t-shirts, mugs, and other gimmicks. Narratives such as Star Wars, Lord of the Rings, A Song of Ice and Fire, or probably the next one will be The Walking Dead, keeps sprouting all the time and suggests that transmedia storytelling is the most important narrative mode of our time. There are even manuals that tell you how to write for transmedia, such as this one. My claim, however, is that much of what passes as transmedia storytelling is really advertising campaigns that use multiple delivery systems to promote really single medium products such as films or TV shows in the hope of reaching a wider audience. So here I propose to examine the possibility of a truly transmedial mode of storytelling, a mode that fulfills Jenkins' definition. Transmedia storytelling represents a process where integral elements of a fiction get dispersed systematically across multiple delivery channels for the purpose of creating a unified and coordinated entertainment experience. Ideally, each medium makes its own unique contribution to the unfolding of the story. The italics are Jenkins, but if I were to underline something, I would underline the same words. So let me begin by dispelling what I take to be a myth about transmedia storytelling, that it is a child of digital technology, and because digital technology has greatly facilitated communication among people, that transmedia storytelling is inherently participatory. I'm not denying any relations between transmediality, participation, and digitality, but throughout this presentation, I will not take the convergence for granted, and I will return to this relation at the end of my talk when we have looked at some examples of transmedia storytelling. This notion of transmedia storytelling involves two basic concepts, story and medium. I will spare you a definition of story. It will take me all day. So I'll ask you to rely on your intuitive conception. Well, the concept of media or medium is far more controversial and merits a discussion. I think it's a very difficult concept to define, and the work of Lars Edelström has really shown how complex this notion of medium is. And myself, I have struggled for many years to come up with a definition, and I haven't come up with anything that really satisfies me. We need a Linnaeus of media. So, Henry Jenkins tells us in Convergence Culture that he regards recorded sound as a medium, while CDs, MP3 files, and 8-track cassettes are delivery technology. So he makes this distinction between media and delivery technology. I don't know when he says recorded sound as a medium, if it's recorded or if it sounds. Anyway, so delivery technologies are things that quickly change over time, but the type of information that they transmit are time-transcending and really limited in number. But the question that Jenkins leaves open is, what are the other members of the set of media besides sound recording? I have come to the conclusion that the concept of medium is really a polysemic term and that it is hopeless to gather all of its uses under one definition. Rather, I think there are at least three conceptions of medium. And their common denominator is that they all concern the creation and the transmission of information. So what are these kinds of media, according to my system? First, you have a semiotic conception. Media are types of signs and means of expression. So according to this definition, media are things like text, sound, music, pictures, moving pictures, gestures, and maybe interactive mechanisms. Second, there is a technological conception. Media are human-designed ways of recording life and of encoding signs, and they make it possible to transmit information from a sender to a receiver who are distant in time or space. So the technological media are writing, film, photography, TV, radio, telephone, various applications of digital technology. And finally, there's a cultural conception. It's what most people have in mind when they speak of the media as a vehicle of mass communication. So here you have the press, radio, television, the internet. And this conception of media is usually pejorative. It's the mean media who have caused the death of Princess Diana, for instance. Also in this cultural conception, I place art forms that cannot really be distinguished on either semiotic or technological grounds, such as theater, opera, comics, dance, and various kinds of installation art. So when we speak about transmedia storytelling, what do we mean? That we could have a novel that generates lots of fan fiction. And this fan fiction is available on the internet. So in terms of technology, we would have two media, but I don't consider this to be transmedia because the novel relies on text, the fan fiction also relies on text, and the internet here serves purely as a delivery system. And here I forgot to say that digital technology is not only a medium with its own affordances, it's also a meta-medium that can relay and transmit all other media. For instance, you can have pictures, you can have text, you can have film on the internet. So this idea of meta-media makes it very difficult to really tell what is a media and what is not. So, the spreading of stories across different cultural or semiotic media is certainly not a new phenomenon. To see this, all you need to do is to consider the dissemination of Greek myths or biblical stories through various art forms such as paintings, stained glass windows, retelling during sermons, or even ways of the cross. I mean, there are millions of transmedia adaptation of Greek myths or Bible, biblical stories. And these various media incarnations are the result of, are not the result of a deliberate decision by the church or by some authority. They are a spontaneous phenomenon which I call a snowball effect. You have a narrative that is culturally so prominent that people spontaneously, automatically will tell it in different media. Then, another phenomenon related to transmedia storytelling is what's known in literary criticism as transfictionality. That's a concept that has been introduced by the Canadian critic Richard Saint-Gelais. He's written a big fat book on transfictionality. And what is transfictionality is when you have the migration of a fictional entity from one text to another. And this is a phenomenon that dates back to the beginning of the novel, which means to the beginning of the age of print. And the best and earliest example of transfictionality is the New Adventures of Don Quixote that were written by Alonso Fernandez de Avellaneda. And when Cervantes saw that there was a sequel to his novel, he decided to write his own sequel. And in his own sequel, Don Quixote meets the Don Quixote of Avellaneda. So it's a very postmodern effect that you have there. So that is the second ancestor. Of course, transfictionality does not necessarily take place across media. Usually it's text to text. And there are three operations that are lead to transfictionality. One is expansion, such as writing sequels and prequels. One is modification, such as changing the fate of a fictional character, such as making a character die when he survives in the original, or vice versa. And then there is transposition, so taking a plot and putting it in a different setting as when you put a Greek myth in the modern world. So all three operations occur in fan fiction because fans are always happy to satirize and parody stories and do whatever all sorts of things with them. But the canonical forms of transmedia storytelling are largely limited to expansion because expansion is the only operation that preserves the integrity of the story world. When you have modification, you have to change your idea of what the story is. When you have transposition, you can't even import the story world. And usually the copyright holders of narrative franchises don't like their content to be gratuitously changed, so they stick to expansion. And finally, another phenomenon that I think is related to transmedia storytelling is the development of stories, of true stories or news stories in mass media. Imagine, for instance, that you are fascinated by some item in the news, such as a very sensational crime that takes place in a high society, and that hasn't been solved. But you are absolutely dying to find out who the culprit is. So you will read or watch or gather all the information that you can about this case, and this information will come from the newspaper, it will come from television, it will come from the internet. So I think that news spontaneously developed in various media environments. And this is possible because with news, you don't have a story that is finished before it is transmitted. The story evolves, and it's been told in fragments. And every time there is more news about these stories, every mass media can grab a piece of that story and tell about it. So one feature that these three ancestors of transmedia storytelling have in common is that their bottom-up spontaneous nature. Most of the story clusters that develop around the cult narratives of our time are also, for the greater part, a bottom-up phenomenon that is prompted by a text that was originally conceived as a standalone. For instance, Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter, Song of Ice and Fire, they all started out as novels, and then because they were popular, they were adaptations in different media. But if we take a careful look at Jenkins' definition, we see that what he has in mind is not a bottom-up grassroots phenomenon, it's really a top-down phenomenon. And I have highlighted in red the parts of the definition that suggest a deliberate distribution of content in different media. So it's this top-down direction that I think represents the true novelty of transmedia storytelling with respect to the three forms that I have described, but it's also its problematic nature. We've had for a long time constellations of text that cluster around a particularly popular narrative, but it is only recently that deliberate attempts have been made to distribute narrative information into text of various media. I'm not saying that top-down and bottom-up are mutually exclusive. If you have a top-down project that is very successful, it will generate fan fiction, it will generate discussion on the internet, and that may be the purpose of the developers. But I think that if there is such a thing as transmedia storytelling, it has to be a top-down phenomenon, if it's going to be more than a sum of its parts. So before I discuss some genuine top-down projects, I'd like to take a look at an exchange between David Bordwell, the famous film scholar, and Henry Jenkins on the merits of transmedia storytelling. So on his blog, Bordwell quote a claim made by the Lance Wilder, who is, I think, a filmmaker of documentary film. Instead of creating a script with its genre formulas and three-act layout, the filmmaker should generate a Bible which plots an ensemble of characters and events that spills across film, website, mobile communication, Twitter, gaming, and other platforms. The filmmaker designs timelines, interaction trees, and flowcharts, as well as story bridges that provide a seamless flow across devices and screens. So as a film scholar, Bordwell is particularly interested in the narrative poetics of Hollywood film, which rest on the notion of a narrative arc leading from exposition to complication to climax to a resolution. And of course, this aesthetics is borrowed from drama and is widely regarded as Aristotelian, even though Aristotle never described such a structure in his poetics. Bordwell's concept of narrativity is also inspired by Meir Sternberg, who writes, "I define narrativity as a play of suspense, curiosity, surprise between represented and communicative time. Along the same functional line, I define narrative as a discourse where such play dominates." So for Bordwell, following Sternberg, narration is essentially a temporal phenomenon leading to certain effects and the distribution of narrative content into multiple documents belonging to different media can only be detrimental to these effects. And I quote, "In between opening and closing, the order in which we get story information is crucial to our experience of the story world. Suspense, curiosity, surprise, and concern for characters all are created by the sequencing of story action programmed into the movie. Facing multiple points of access, no two consumers are likely to encounter story information in the same order. If I start a novel at chapter one, if you start at chapter 10, we simply haven't experienced the artwork in the same way." In other words, transmedia storytelling suffers from the same deficiency as hypertext fiction, a narrative form that never really gained traction, because in hypertext fiction, everybody clicks on different links, get the story in different order, and it's impossible to create such effects as suspense, curiosity, and surprise, which, according to Bordwell and Sternberg, are essential to narrativity. To these objections, Jenkins answers that not every fictional work should become a transmedia franchise. In other words, there are other types of narrative structure than the Aristotelian plot favored by Hollywood, and the key to transmedia storytelling is to find the right type. What is this type? A narrative consists of a spatial component, the story world, and of a temporal component, the plot or story. In some narratives, the plot is the world is subordinated to the plot. It's the world is the environment that sustains the characters. In other narratives, the plot is subordinated to the world. It functions as a path that takes the user through the world and reveals its landscape, or something like this. This is Middle Earth, and you can say that the plot allows you to discover different aspects of Middle Earth. So here is how I personally rank some narrative genre with respect to whether the interest comes from the plot or from the world. So at the top, interesting in both ways, are the great masterpieces of the realistic novel, such as War and Peace. I put tragedy and thrillers high interest in the plot, not so much in the world, especially for tragedy. I think a tragedy is supposed to highlight universal aspects of the human nature, and it doesn't really matter what is the context. And so a Greek tragedy is best represented on a bare stage with no distracting props. On the other hand, there are two genres where the interest is in the world rather than in a plot. It's fantasy and science fiction, because these are worlds that depart from the real world, and it takes a lot of invention to create these worlds. And usually the plot is rather stereotyped. And finally, at the bottom, something that is interesting neither for the plot nor for the world is the story the king died and the queen died of grief. Of course, E.M. Forster did not propose that as an artwork. It's just an example of the structure of a plot. So what do we need for transmedia storytelling? We need something that is high interest in the world and not so much in the plot. And here I quote Jenkins again. The transmedia approach enhances certain kinds of works that have been judged harshly by traditional aesthetic criteria because they are less concentrated on plot or even character than more classically constructed narratives. It's long been a charge against science fiction works that they are more interested in mapping complex environments than in telling compelling stories. Most of my favorite science fiction novels, Snow Crash, for example, break down into near incoherence by the end, but they offer us a richly realized world that I would love to be able to explore in greater detail than any one narrative allows. So, but if the world of Snow Crash is really richly realized, why does it take other narratives to explore it on a level of detail that Jenkins would love? The desire we may develop for other stories taking place in a given story world comes mainly from the fact that when we have invested the cognitive effort necessary to construct mentally a world, we don't want to be expelled from this world at the end of the book or at the end of the movie, and we would love to return to a familiar world because it saves us cognitive effort. And that's why the genres that have generated the most transmedia activity are genres like science fiction and fantasy, which, in my opinion, demand a much greater cognitive effort than reading realistic fiction, because when you read realistic fiction, you can apply what I call the principle of minimal departure. In other words, you can import knowledge from everyday life, while when you have a very exotic science fiction or fantasy world, you cannot do that. So, to sum up the Bordwell-Jenkins debate, Bordwell says, you can't break up a story into multiple fragments, into multiple media. It's not good. Imagine how annoying it would be to read a chapter of a book, and then you have to go to a movie to get the second chapter, and then you have to play a computer game to find out how it ends. So when you have a story arc, don't break it. On the other hand, Jenkins tells us, you can tell many stories about a given world because a world is a spatial container that has room for many different stories. Let's now turn to some of the few truly top-down existing specimens of transmedia storytelling. And I will discuss three examples that illustrate three types of narrative architecture. And my first example is borrowed completely from Henry Jenkins' convergence culture. It is The Matrix. The Matrix is the epitome of a top-down approach to transmedia storytelling. You have three films released in 1999 and 2003. They were accompanied by short anime films, by comics and computer games, which they had been specially commissioned by the authors of the films, Andy and Larry Wachowski. The most notable feature of the Matrix franchise is that its individual elements depend on each other for a better understanding of the whole. So in transmedia storytelling, the various media stand in a relation of competition with each other as much as they stand in a relation of cooperation, because when a bit of story is given to a medium, it must be taken away from another medium to avoid too much redundancy. So if too much is taken away, in other words, if there is no redundancy whatsoever, the elements of the system will be incomplete and the user will be frustrated. But if the elements of the system are fully autonomous, the user will have no incentive to explore other documents. So you have to maintain a balance between redundancy and novelty. So the design philosophy of the Wachowskis is clearly aimed at cultivating a desire to look beyond the films, especially when it comes to the relation between the films and the computer games. For instance, in the film The Matrix Reloaded, the good guys succeed in their final mission because a character named Niobe and her team manage to cut down the electrical power that feeds the machines. And this event is not shown in the film. So it's a plot hole. But when you play the game, one of your missions is to cut down the electrical power of to the machine so that playing the game fills a plot hole in the film. Or to take another example, there's an episode in The Matrix Reloaded where the main character, Neo, encounters a new character named The Kid. And for the spectator of the film, it's a totally new character. You've never seen him before. But from the dialogue, you find out that they know each other. They have had the communication before. So again, this is a plot hole in the film. But if you watch one of the short anime film, then you'll have the story of the first encounter between Neo and the kid. So we can represent the structure of the Matrix like this. The game would be some kind of Swiss cheese with lots of plot holes, and these holes would be filled by the other media objects, and the other media would themselves have holes that can be filled by the film. But that does not mean that the system can be entered through any of its elements. Take, for instance, the story of the kid. In the short film, Neo contacts the kid on his cell phone. The kid commits himself to Neo. Then he's pursued by the agents. He falls from the roof. And instead of killing himself, he ends up in the real world, because you know that in the Matrix, what looks like a real world is a simulation created by the machine. So the kid falls from the roof and ends up in the real world, which is a spaceship where Neo and Morpheus plot their war against the machines. So if you haven't seen the feature film of The Matrix, you will know nothing about this situation. You won't know who the agents are, you won't know who Neo is, you won't know that the world is really a simulation. So the short film is not really self-sufficient. And it has rather big plot holes, while The Matrix films, feature films, have very small plot holes. And for most spectators, they don't even notice these plot holes because, I mean, there is so much action, so much special effects that it distracts spectators from the logic of the plot. So I think that the entry point to The Matrix is really the feature films, and since it's the most popular of the media being used, I doubt that anybody entered the system through either the comic books or through the anime films. My second example of transmedia storytelling is a German TV project called Alpha 07, Der Feind in dir, which means the enemy within, that was produced in 2010 by the Südwestrundfunk. And the main document of Alpha 07 was a short TV series, 6 installments of 30 minutes each. And It came with a number of satellite documents available on the internet, and there was also a series of radio shows that were broadcast, I think, a few months later, that presented a sequel to the miniseries. Alpha 07 tells a story situated in Germany in the year 2017. And in this world, there's a company called Protecta, which plans to introduce security systems that take the form of brain scanning technologies. So when somebody develops the kind of shot that could lead to violent crime, a chip will be implanted in the brain of this person, and this person will become a harmless person. So that there will be absolutely total security for the citizens of Germany, because all the criminals will be turned into law-abiding citizens. But of course, that will also violate the individual's right to privacy. So the plot of the TV series concerns a young woman named Johanna, who is hired by Protecta as a test subject. And she's the seventh test subject, that's why it's called Alpha 07. And the first six have either disappeared or committed suicide. So Protecta implants a chip in Johanna's brain, of course without her knowledge, and controls her behavior. Meanwhile, an underground movement called Apollo fights to maintain freedom of thought. So in the course of the plot, Johanna is captured, escapes from Protecta, she makes contact with Apollo, Apollo removes the chip, then she's captured again by Protecta, the chip she put back in, then she's freed again, and in the last episode she's free from Protecta, but she's wanted by the police because when she was under the influence of Protecta, she attempted a crime for which she must now pay. And so she's now a fugitive, and this is the subject matter of the radio shows. So Alpha 07 uses television and radio to tell the story, but it also uses a website to provide supplementary documents about the story world. For instance, there is a fictional blog maintained by Apollo that discusses the ethical dilemma of imposing security on the population at the cost of privacy. Then there is a website of Protecta, and you can even send a mail to Protecta. There is a, it says contact us, so if you contact Protecta, they will reply and send, tell you we are a fictional company. Then there is a fictional ad for Protecta. This guy is a convicted rapist, but he had a Protecta chip implanted into his brain, and he has now become a good citizen, and he says, thanks to Protecta, now I'm freed from a life in jail. Then there is also this fictional TV spot looking for Stefan Hartmann. Stefan Hartmann was the first Alpha 01. He has mysteriously disappeared. And so the spectator is encouraged to solve the mystery of the disappearance. For instance, you can click on number two, link list, the list of the links that were on Stefan Hartmann's computer after he disappeared. And there you will discover several interesting documents, one of which is a real-world document, the website of Homeland Security, a program called Hostile Intent Detection. So that's a real program, but it's incorporated into the story world. There's another link that points to new advances in neuroscience that shows that neuroscience is very close to being able to read thoughts. So all these real-world documents have their reference subverted and redirected toward the fictional world. And what the point of this is to tell you, this is a fictional world, but it's not that different from the real world. And if you don't do anything, the real world by the year 2017 will be like this. And in fact, with recent revelation by the National Security Agency wishing that the real world is not that different from the world of Alpha 07. So, as I hope to have suggested through this summary, the interest of Alpha 07 lies much more in the story world and in the ethical dilemma that it highlights than in the plot. The plot is a rather conventional thriller. The vast majority of spectators will probably limit their exploration of the story world to the TV series, and they will only get to know those features that can be seen from the trail of the plot. But the users who consult the satellite documents will gain a broader view of the story world and of its relation to the actual world. So the additional documents play the same role as descriptions in a novel. They do not move the action forward, but they flesh out the world. And I think that's how we can represent the system of Alpha 07. First, you have the TV series that present a small version of the story world, and this story world expands through the additional documents, especially the documents that are taken from the real world and redirected towards the fictional world. Or you can represent like this. If you all you do is watch the TV series, you get to see the orange part, but if you, the more documents you consult, the more you will see of the story world. So I think that Alpha 07 can be considered a prototypical case of transmedia storytelling. Now I would like to turn to a much more marginal example. In fact, whether it's really transmedia storytelling depends how you define the term. This example points to a new direction, the use of multiple media to tell not fictional stories, but real-world stories. There's no reason why transmedia storytelling should be limited to the kind of fantastic world that dominates popular culture and inspires commercial franchises. Nor is there any reason why it should be limited to fiction. As I have suggested in my discussion of the predecessors of transmedia, we tend to follow our favorite stories through a variety of media. And this bottom-up activity could easily be transformed into a top-down design that carefully monitors the user's discovery of the story. So my next project stands actually halfway between fiction and reality. It's a transmedia exploration of counterfactual history, so an exploration of what could have been if a certain idea had been realized. This idea that was not realized but was conceived was conceived in 1825 by Mordecai Noah, who was a prominent member of the New York Jewish community, and he came upon the idea of creating a Jewish homeland on Grand Island in upstate New York, very close to Niagara Falls. The project never got any further than a festive opening ceremony during which a monument was erected. I think you can still see the monument, but the town was never constructed. But the project is being revived in a project that is still under development that's called Mapping Ararat. The main medium involved in Mapping Ararat is augmented reality. The project transports users into Mordecai Noah's brainchild by inviting them to a walk through Grand Island, during which they will encounter virtual images of what Ararat could have been like and how it would have developed through the 20th century. So in this case, you have technological virtuality that captures historical virtuality. So here are a few of the sites that you get to see. First, you receive a paper map that shows the location of the augments. And first, you use, of course, your smartphone. You can use see the synagogue. You can see the grave of Mordecai Noah, who is really buried in New York City, the grave of his wife. And because the developers didn't have many things to show, they imagined how Ararat would develop in the 20th century. So this is a movie house that shows a film adaptation of one of the plays of Mordecai Noah, because he was a playwright. And it's starring Bernie Schwartz. You may have heard of Bernie Schwartz under the name of Tony Curtis. So that's the movie house of Ararat. And probably people of Ararat would have found ways to commercialize their settlement, and they would have constructed a water park, so at the gate to the water park. There was not only this virtual augmented reality tour. You were invited to take pictures of yourself, so these are real people in front of Noah's Ark. And there are also a number of objects that were developed. There was a flag, there was coins, there were postage stamps, and this is the currency of Ararat. And there are also a number of souvenirs that you can buy and send to your relatives using the postage stamps of Ararat. Of course, here you have a problem because this is an augmented reality exhibit. So how do you insert a material object in a virtual reality exhibit? I suppose there would be some kind of kiosk. And some people need an audio guide that will tell them the story of Ararat. They also will need a paper map. So if you will need a kiosk to distribute these objects, so the kiosk could also sell souvenirs. So transmedia structure of Ararat can be represented like this. You have a core experience that depends on three media, the augmented reality display, and to enjoy this display, you need a map, which is a piece of paper, and you need an audio file. The coordination of these three media transports the visitor into a simulation of Mordecai Noah's vision of Ararat, or rather a simulation of what it would have been in the 21st century. Then you have two more media. You have photography, where you can take pictures of yourself, as I showed you. And then you have all the gimmicks that you can buy. And so this expand the story world, but they redirect the focus. When you see the virtual reality, the augmented reality display, you pretend that this is Ararat. But when you start taking photos and buying gimmicks, you pretend that you are visiting a theme park. So there is a self-reflexive effect when you use the second layer. The transmediality of mapping Ararat rests mainly on the fact that the augmented reality experience must be supported by a printed map and audio guidelines. But since the three types of information cannot be separated, otherwise, I mean, it would be very boring to visit the installation, mapping Ararat may be more a case of multimodal than of transmedial narration. This means that rather than satisfying Jenkins' definition, it's more similar to the opera, which narrates through music, text, and visual display. The difference between transmediality and multimodality is not always clear, but I think a reliable criterion is the autonomy of the different types of information. In multimediality, the different types are contained in different documents, and the user must go search for these documents. But in multimodality, they are given as a package and they cannot be separated. You cannot take the music out of an opera, or you cannot take the visuals. But if you have a true multimedia projects, you can decide to see a film or to hear maybe a CD with some music, and these are different objects. So I'd like to return to the issue of the relations between digital technology, participatory culture, and transmedia storytelling. So first, look at digital technology. In the Matrix, you have only one type of document, the games that are digital born. All the others are old media. And as I've said, all the items must be bought separately, and that's one of the purposes of the Matrix franchise, is to have people buy and spend lots of money. In Alpha 07, some documents are old media, the TV and radio shows, while others are new media, the blog and the web pages. But Alpha 07 makes very limited use of the affordances of new media. There is just, they are not very interactive. There's just on the web page of Protecta, you can click to send an email to Protecta. But what's different between the Matrix and Alpha 07 is that Alpha 07 uses digital media as a delivery system. They have this web page where all the documents are available, and as soon as the TV episodes were shown, they were put on a website, also same for the radio shows, so that you can access all the documents in one place. So the only one of the three projects that uses an application of digital technology as mothership is Mapping Ararat, since it's built around an augmented reality installation. Next, consider participation. As I've already suggested, one of the basic guidelines of transmedia design is give the users something to do. It's hoped that by enlisting the active participation of the users, stories will spread to social media and receive the publicity that will keep them alive. For, as Henry Jenkins puts it, a maxim of the entertainment industry is, if it doesn't spread, it's dead. In the Matrix franchise, active participation is reduced to playing the video games. There's also some Matrix fan fiction, but this is not part of the top-down planning. This is more a bottom-up phenomenon. And since there are about 3,000 pieces of Matrix fan fiction on the internet, it's very unlikely that any piece will be read by more than a handful of people, so they do not really contribute to the expansion of the Matrix narrative system. In Alpha 07, some of the web pages have a modest interactive dimension. As I said, you can send an email to Protecta, and you can put comments on the website, but there weren't many comments because it was not a very successful project. In fact, most German people I've talked to have never heard of Alpha 07, even though it got several prizes. It was critically acclaimed, but I think it was poorly publicized, and it ran at 10 o'clock in the evening on a Sunday, so it was not a good time for a TV show, not in prime time. And they were trying to make the project more interactive by connecting it to an augmented reality game, an ARG. In fact, I showed you this spot with Stefan Hartmann, and the user was invited to solve the mystery. So that was supposed to be the rabbit hole that leads into the ARG, but they ran out of money, and the ARG was never completed. Finally, in Ararat, active participation consists of walking around the space of the installation and to catch the augmentations. These examples show that even though transmedia storytelling can make use of digital media, and capitalize on their potential for audience participation, their bread and butter remains the storytelling power of old media, a power that is linear and mostly monological. By this, I mean it comes from an author rather than being collectively created. So to conclude, is transmedia storytelling myth or reality? It is certainly reality. By transmedia storytelling, we understand a marketing strategy. The set of people who read books is not the same as the set of people who watch TV serials, and this group is not the same as the group that uses smartphones, computer games, or social media. So by expanding story worlds to multiple media, developers will reach different people. But from an aesthetic point of view, spreading the story across as many media as possible is not a valid goal. If transmedia storytelling is to be more than a buzzword of the entertainment industry, if it's going to enhance the narrative experience of a given audience rather than court new audiences for a given story, then if it's going to develop into a new form of art, it will have to do a number of things. First, it will have to create a compelling story world or explore a compelling aspect of the real world. Once you have a good world, you will want to tell as many stories as you can about it, since people prefer to return to a familiar world than having to construct one from scratch. How do you tell many stories about a given world? I forgot this. To engage people in a world, give the user something to do, such as solving a mystery. And that was the Stefan Hartmann idea was to engage people by solving a mystery. So then when you have a world and you give a user something to do, then you want to tell several stories about this world. And here you have three principles: presenting the story from several points of views, so from the point of view of different characters, maybe from an omniscient point of view, then from a point of view of a specific character. In Alpha 07, the omniscient point of view is, of course, the TV show, but then one of the documents is a blog of Johanna, and you can see how she's afraid of losing her mind, so it gives you a very personal perspective that I think the film cannot do. Then expand the time frame through prequels, sequels, and midquels, and expand the breadth of the story world by telling the story of minor characters. So in Alpha 07, they could have told the story of all the alphas from 1 to 6 before focusing on Johanna. But these rules can be implemented in transfictional projects that use a single medium. So to pass from transfictionality to transmediality, it will be necessary to justify the use of multiple media by, first, taking advantage of the specific affordances of the specific media, and second, distributing narrative information among media in a strategically meaningful way. And there is really no surefire recipe for implementing these principles. And that's why there are so many cult narratives that spill across media through a snowball effect, but there are very few examples of deliberate top-down transmedia storytelling. Thank you.
Thank you, for this fascinating talk. And now the floor is open to questions. I think, judging by the abstracts you sent for your presentations to this conference, this presentation of Marie-Laure's touched on subjects that are connected to many of your presentations. So I imagine there will be some questions, perhaps. Yes? I don't know.
Thank you. it was really interesting presentation, and I'm studying transmedia storytelling myself, so I was particularly interested in this. And you tackled one of my questions exactly, and I'm not sure if you gave an answer. So my question is, what can you consider transmedia storytelling? How can you separate, let's say, transmedia practices that can be applied to many fields? Because if you, let's say, include in the same category of transmedia storytelling, the matrix and an experiment of the mapping Ararat, enhanced, let's say, exhibition. So what is the link between them? It's just a matter of using multiple medium, because to me they're completely different experiences, and I can't see much of storytelling in Ararat.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And in fact, I said this is an imaginary case. Yeah, I consider Alpha 07 to be the prototypical case, and mapping Ararat is a very marginal case. I think it's more multimodal than multimedia. But still, if you have a broad definition, it uses a different media. It uses visuals, it uses audio, it uses photography. So if the only criteria is how many technologies or how many semiotic science are involved, then mapping Ararat could be considered. But and it doesn't even tell much of a story, really. I think it's more a game of make-believe where the user pretends to visit Ararat. But I think that the audio guide tells a story. But there's also the question of ARGs. Some people consider them to be transmedia storytelling because you have different delivery systems. You can get a message that comes through the cell phone, you can through the internet, you can have live actors, and you have to reconstitute a story out of these cues that come from different delivery systems. So is this transmedia storytelling or is it not? I don't know. So I think that it's really a fuzzy set with some typical cases. And I would put Alpha 07 at the center. Matrix would be also fairly typical. But then you have these very marginal cases.
Anybody else?
Thank you. Yes, very, very interesting presentation. And I wanted to ask, you said at the beginning that you have these cases that were top-bottom. And have you come across any cases that are bottom-up?
Any narrative franchise that develops around a cult narrative where you first have the novel, and then somebody makes a film adaptation, then somebody makes a computer game, and all these objects are conceived independently of each other. I consider this a bottom-up. It's by popular demand, if you want. And also the biblical stories, the Greek myths, are all bottom-up.
Hi, I'm Henry Jenkins. It sort of seems silly to say that. And so I'm sure the crowd would love to see fireworks explode and feathers fly, but in truth, you arrive at more or less the same place my thinking has evolved over time. I find myself very much in sympathy. It's enormously flattering to have a narrative theorist at your caliber really working through my stuff as closely as you have and as thoughtfully as you have. So I'm not sure I even have a question so much as just a signal that, and from where I'm sitting, most of the apparent disagreements here are maybe misunderstandings. So I would never, for example, have asserted that the transmedia requires a digital component. Mm-hmm. In fact, I'm in the talk that I'm doing tomorrow, I'm going to talk about the ways in which an early 20th century property, WAS, has some transmedia elements to it and the ways in which it's been executed. Where I would have differed a little, I think, here is we were using the word interactivity and participation in somewhat different ways. So I would not have argued that the interactive components of the matrix say make it participatory, because for me, interactivity refers to technical affordances and participation requires cultural practices. For me, what made the matrix participatory was the degree to which it required active decipherment of people comparing notes online, and that seemed actively courted by the kind of by the producers and by the way the text itself made so many dense intertextual relationships. That's not to say the works before the matrix didn't do the same thing in terms of intertextuality, but insofar as there's a case to be made that the matrix is participatory, it's that this sort of dispersed information encourages people, as I call them, to be hunters and gatherers who bring things together more than it is about sort of having specific things they're assigned to do by the technology and its design. So that would be the off the top of my head reactions, but I actually found myself, this last slide, there's nothing here that we would be in disagreement about, I think.
Well, I can only say that I totally agree with your distinction between interactivity and participatory, because interactivity is really one person and a computer, so it does not involve communication. While participatory, you have these masses of people who do exchange information. So the matrix for you inspired the kind of behavior that we have in alternate reality games, even though it was not an alternate reality game. Maybe it was inspiration because they came up shortly afterwards. Okay. And I studied your blog very carefully and gathered lots of ideas from it. And also an idea from you that I totally agree with is that adaptation is not transmedia, because adaptation is ideally a retelling of the same story, while you say that transmedia should really tell you more things about the world, explore the world. Of course, purists of adaptation will say no adaptation retells, it always expands, or it transposes, or it fills in gaps, so there is no perfect adaptation, but still, I think that the phenomenon of adaptation itself is not the same thing as transmedia. But once we expel adaptation from transmedia, what is left? Because
you talked about let me try to phrase this. You talked about plot holes. That is an important component of transmedia storytelling, because of plot holes, different media can create a greater narrative. But what about television series such as Lost, for example, in which there are large plot holes, but at the same time there is not a central author who creates for instance, a wiki on the internet in which these plot holes are filled, but there's participation, but at the same time, the medium itself invites this type of participatory storytelling. And how is that different from transmedia storytelling, except from the fact that it's not created by a single power, in a way?
Well, I think that the plot of Lost invites transmedia, or invites fan fiction or expansion, because there are so many characters. And so I think something that would be interesting to study is what shapes of plot invite either transfictionality or transmedia. But wasn't there Lost, there was an ARG, and wasn't it sponsored by the same developers as the series? It was supposed to publicize it, so there's some kind of top-down. And I think when something is very successful, you have both top-down and bottom-up. I've read the article by Jason Bittel where he talks about the arg of Lost and he thinks that it's very disappointing. It has a little connection to the show.
I also want to thank you for a great presentation up here way in the back in the Peanut Gallery. Mm-hmm. And I was really impressed with your choice of three examples of transmedia and how different they are and how similar they are. And it struck me that it was interesting that you chose Matrix because Matrix is old. In a digital time frame, it's ancient. It's next to Homer. So I'm wondering, and yet I can't think of anything that had the sort of broad cultural impact that that movie did, or that rather that that transmedia production did. Can you think of something that came close, or if not, why not?
Well, that's the problem with studying transmedia, that there are not that many examples of it.
But okay, I'm thinking about this two ways. One is just sort of a thinker about culture, but I try to put my head inside a Hollywood producer. They all have to be looking at Matrix and saying, let's do it again. And they have all the resources of Hollywood, and yet they've never come close.
You know that we have now more resources than when they did the movie?
Oh, absolutely. In terms of the impact of social media is mega times more powerful than it was at that time.
Well, but social media is spontaneous, it's bottom-up.
It is bottom-up.
So you can really program the people to respond to a movie. So, well, what could you do that Matrix didn't do? I think in terms of special effects, they have not improved that much. And in fact, there are so many special effects in the Matrix that it's absolutely tiring. I mean, I loved the first movie, but uh-huh. I couldn't stand second and third. But I mean, it's a very interesting topic philosophically. Mm-hmm. But
yes.
I think that they lost the philosophical thread in the second and third movie, and they got swallowed up by the special effects. So I don't know how we could redo the Matrix in a way that would be more transmedia, really. Maybe Henry could tell.
You want the microphone down there?
I have a question concerning you make a sweeping remark on the differences between science fiction fantasy versus realist novels.
Yeah.
I was very amazed. I'm not quite sure I even got your point, but I think you said that it took much less a cognitive effort to read a realistic novel, so that's why they wouldn't be put into, for instance, a transmedia storytelling constellation.
What was I saying? It takes more effort to construct the world of a science fiction novel because everything is so strange, so new. And once.
But isn't that a question of cultural training, so to speak? If you've read lots of science fiction novels.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
So it. Mm-hmm. And then your point was that because you have made this effort, then you don't want to waste it, then you want to go on to.
You want more of the same world.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, it's
perhaps, but it struck me as a very sweeping kind of definition of what's going on in realist fiction and science fiction, fantasy fiction.
I find it strange that all the narrative franchises are all about fantasy and science fiction, and why not about the real world? In fact, I have a friend who is now working on a transmedia project about the real world. It's about the fires recently in Colorado. And so he's developing film and oral history and written documents, and all this should come together and give a more complete idea of a phenomenon. And I think the future of transmedia is really for real world stories rather than for fiction. And I don't know why there is not more of it.
It could be a question of culture also, of being participants in fan sites and so on, which is more kind of cultural thing for certain reader groups.
Yeah.
Who doesn't read Middlemarch instead of reading Tolkien, perhaps.
But there is a Jane Austen phenomenon that's about where it's a bottom-up transmedia. You have the novels, you have the films, you have the TV series, you have lots of Jane Austen fan fiction. So it's not true that it's all about fantasy and science fiction.
Okay, very short. You said at one point, I mean, this is talking about fantastic and realistic fiction, but at one point you also said there's not only fictional transmedia storytelling, there could also be factual.
Yeah.
But, I mean, if there is one factional transmedia storytelling, how can you claim that any kind of media representation is not part of it? I mean, I would say every image taken today yours is part of it, so there's just one. Right? There can't be more than one factual transmedia storytelling, because everything is part of that one.
Well, I think that the distribution of information about the real world could be planned in a transmedia way. And right now, we gather information about real world events by hunting and hunting for documents, and that's something we do ourselves spontaneously. But why couldn't there be, a study, as I say, this project about the fires in Colorado? There would be a website that would send readers or spectators to various documents, and that would be done deliberately top-down. So there would be, of course, there would be more information that would be part of the system, but there would be also a designed experience.
Okay, thank you, everybody. Our time has run out, but I encourage everybody to continue all these questions and discussions throughout the conference and throughout the coffee breaks, perhaps, and even later in the evening throughout the reception if you still have energy. But now we have to start the sessions in the other building. Thank you, everybody. And thank you, Marianne.